Let's turn to John chapter 4. It begins, "Therefore, when the Lord knew that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself did not baptize but his disciples, he left Judea and departed again to Galilee. But he needed to go through Samaria." Now, Jesus decides at this point to depart from Judea, where his ministry up to this point has been taking place. He had been in Galilee before. Of course, he grew up there. In fact, his first miracle was wrought in Galilee, in the turning of water into wine. But that was not a public spectacle. Only the servants knew that he had done a miracle there, and the disciples. Even the master of ceremonies at the feast didn't know where the wine that had been once water came from. But it says, of course, the servants knew, and the disciples knew and believed in him. So this was kind of a more or less private miracle he had done. He has not yet in Galilee begun a public ministry and put his own powers and claims on display. This was to await the time when John the Baptist was taken out of circulation. And we found in John chapter 3 and verse 24, it says, "For John was not yet put in prison." That is at the point in time described in John chapter 3, verse 24. John was still not in prison. But in all the other Gospels, it says, when John was put into prison, Jesus came into Galilee, saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand." So we now read between John 3:24 and this point, John is put into prison. And when he was put into prison, that's when the other Gospels say that was the signal for Jesus to begin his Galilean ministry. And he began preaching the very same message John had preached. Because John, before he was put in prison, was preaching, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And then John's put in prison. Now Jesus preaches that same message throughout Galilee. In many ways, Jesus was picking up the torch from John the Baptist, but going to carry it much further. And so it is with the imprisonment of John the Baptist, though John doesn't mention it here, that Jesus made this trek to Galilee. John gives us another motivation, not a contrary one, just an additional one, is that Jesus had been in Judea, and that's where the scribes and the Pharisees held a great sway. Actually, they did throughout the country, but especially in Judea, that was a place where, you know, the chief priests and all the power brokers in the nation that were eventually not going to be very friendly toward Jesus. At this point, they had taken a very avid resistance to him, but these people were strong in Judea. Much stronger, much more influential there than in Galilee. And here Jesus found out that news had reached the Pharisees that he, Jesus, was now baptizing more people than John had. Now the Pharisees had not liked John, and they had resented his popularity. And now if they're hearing that Jesus is even more popular than John, or perhaps they've heard that John by now has been put in prison and they were relieved, but then they've heard that, the same thing's going on with this new guy. In fact, more people are coming to him than were going to John. We thought we were done with John, but now we've got this same kind of movement continuing in what may have looked to them like a successor to John. Certainly, Jesus was not a successor to John. In the end of chapter 3, John himself said that Jesus was more like the bridegroom to John's best man. The bridegroom's not the successor to the best man. And the bridegroom is what the wedding is all about, him and the bride. The bridegroom's friend, the best man, is just kind of an auxiliary figure, and that's what John said he was. And Jesus is the bridegroom, and the people are the bride. And Jesus has come to take his bride, like the Messiah would do. However, the news that Jesus' popularity, at least as a baptizer, was exceeding that of John, could not bode well for Jesus in the eyes and the estimate of the Pharisees. They would see him as a threat. And at this point, Jesus was not quite ready to incur their deadly hatred toward him. And so he apparently intended to put some distance between him and them by going to Galilee. And that's what it says here. Now, in the midst of telling us that, it says Jesus himself really didn't baptize people, but his disciples. That seems almost like it could say he didn't baptize anyone except his disciples, that he baptized them and maybe they baptized the rest. Maybe. Or it's more likely it means that Jesus did not personally baptize people with his own hands, but he did it through his disciples. His disciples did it in his name. And this, of course, was what they did even after Pentecost. They baptized in his name. That is, as his agents. That's what it means to do something in someone's name. If the disciples were baptizing people in Jesus' name, it was they were standing as Christ's agents, baptizing people as he would. And they were doing that already at this point. Though it was probably more a baptism along the significance of John's rather than the significance of baptism after the resurrection. We won't worry about that issue right now. The point is that Jesus wasn't really doing the baptizing personally. It was being done on his behalf by his disciples. Nonetheless, what is said to be done by his disciples on his behalf is done by him in the manner that is so commonly used in Scripture. When somebody is said to do something, many times they didn't do it personally, they did it through an agent. And so it says he needs to go through Samaria. Now, why did he need to go through Samaria? One might say, well, it was, you know, a geographical necessity. The land of Israel had three provinces, vertically arranged, that is from south to north, and the eastern boundary was the Jordan River. On the other side of the Jordan, on the east, there was what they called Transjordania or Perea. That was not technically Israel, but it was a lot of the Jews lived over there, and Jesus actually did a lot of ministry over there eventually. But Judea was the southernmost province on the west side of the Jordan in the main body of the land of Israel. The northernmost was Galilee, and in between them, almost like a buffer state, was Samaria. Now, Judea was the what had grown from the days of the return of the exiles from Babylon. Back when the nation had split, back in the days of Rehoboam, Judah, the southern tribe of Judah, remained faithful to the house of David. The rest branched off the northern kingdoms and they became something else. Well, they got captured by the Assyrians in 722 BC and disappeared. They didn't disappear entirely. They kind of just faded because the Jewish people, or the Israelites, in the northern part of the country intermarried with the pagans in the area. That was actually the Assyrian policy. They deported a lot of the native peoples and brought in other peoples to intermingle them so that the racial integrity would break down and there wouldn't be, of course, much racial patriotism to rise up against Assyria, their conquerors. So what happened is the northern tribes, once they were conquered by Assyria, pretty much intermarried. And they actually became mixed blood and mixed religious. It says in 2 Kings that they feared Yahweh and served other gods. So it's clear that they kind of mixed their Yahwehism, their Judaism, with paganism. And so they had a sort of a half-breed religion as well as a half-breed bloodline. These people were despised by the pure-blooded Jews who still stayed true to the temple in the southern kingdom. And those people who had become so mixed in the north were the Samaritans in the time of Jesus. They were called the Samaritans. The northern kingdom that was conquered by Assyria had its capital city was Samaria. And the region in the time of Jesus, during the Roman occupation, the whole region was called Samaria. And it was inhabited by the descendants, 700 years removed. But the descendants of those northern tribes that had intermarried with Gentiles, and therefore they were kind of half-breed Jews with sort of a half-breed religion. Very much despised by the pure-blooded Jews and the pure religion Jews, especially people like the Pharisees, in the south in Judea. Now, north of Samaria was Galilee. And Galilee was not inhabited by Samaritans so much, but by a mixture of Jews who remained Jewish in their bloodline and Gentiles who were not Jewish, because the Gentiles pretty much dominated Galilee. It was called Galilee of the Gentiles, in fact, in Scripture and elsewhere. So Galilee was kind of a mixed area where there were Jews and Gentiles, but not interbreeding with each other, as in Samaria. So you've got in the southern extremity of the country, Judea, which is the pure blue blood Jewish people, and they felt that way about themselves, that they were the blue bloods, and they were the elite.
Then at the north there was Jewish people who lived in the midst of Gentiles in Galilee, and then in between there was this buffer zone of Samaria that was kind of where the Jews and Gentiles had mixed centuries ago. And so they weren't really Jewish or Gentile, they're just something in between. Now, the people of Judea did not highly respect Galileans, but they absolutely despised Samaritans. And there was great hostility between the Samaritans and the Jews, which is what made Jesus' parable of the Good Samaritan so striking, because the man in question who fell among thieves was a Jew in the parable. And his Jewish brothers, even a priest and a Levite, did not risk helping him in order to save their own skin and get away from the place where robbers lurked. The priest and the Levite just went on by without helping him. But the man who did help him was a Samaritan, a man of a race that was hated by the Jews, by even the victim himself in all likelihood. And yet, that's what made this parable so striking, because Samaritans were hated by the Jews, and the Jews were pretty much hated by the Samaritans. They had a rival religion. They even had a rival religious center. As the Jews had Jerusalem and the temple there, the Samaritans had a house. They built a temple on Mount Gerizim. Mount Gerizim, you may remember, in the days of Joshua, was the place where God had commanded Joshua to set up two stones, whitewashed and engraved with the laws on them. And then some of the tribes, six of the tribes, were to stand on Mount Gerizim, and six on Mount Ebal across the valley from there, and they were pronounced blessings and cursings. Mount Gerizim was the mountain of blessing. It also looked down on Shechem. Shechem was the first place in the Holy Land that had an altar to Yahweh. Abraham had come and built an altar there. It was also the place where Jacob first bought some property in that area. It was the first property owned in the Promised Land by anyone of Israel's family. And Shechem was therefore highly regarded. And Mount Gerizim that overlooked it was considered to be a sacred mountain to the Samaritans. In fact, there's still a small remnant of Samaritan people today, and Mount Gerizim is still the most sacred site in the world as far as they're concerned. In fact, in their estimation, it's the tallest mountain in the world. It isn't, but that's what they think of it as. They think of Mount Gerizim as the tallest mountain in the world, just as, of course, the Jews think of Jerusalem that way. And so there was this rivalry with rival religions, rival shrines. And when it said Jesus must go through Samaria, it would be geographically convenient to go directly through Samaria because it stood right between where he was and where he was going. But most Jews would not go into Samaria. And if they had to go between Judea and Galilee, they would leave the country. They would exit the country. They'd cross east of the Jordan to get out of the country. And then if they're coming from Judea, they'd move north till they had passed the northern boundary of Samaria and then cross the Jordan back into the country in Galilee. They would avoid Samaria. The Pharisees even believed that if the wind that blew across Samaria blew on you, you were unclean. That's how they felt about the Samaritans. And so when it says Jesus must go through Samaria, on one hand, it seems like it was convenient if you're going from Judea to Galilee, but Jews usually didn't do it the most direct route. They take a circuitous route to avoid going through Samaria. So to say that Jesus needed to go through Samaria, it means there was a moral necessity of it rather than a geographical necessity. It could have been avoided. But he needed to go there because that's what his father, of course, was directing him to do. There was an important divine encounter, a divine appointment that had to be made. Did Jesus know that there was going to be a divine appointment? He may have. He may not have. Remember, in his earthly incarnation, he didn't know everything. He was just following his father's will. But he knew that he had to go through Samaria for some reason. And this chapter will, of course, as it unfolds, make it clear why. So, verse 5, he came to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. It is mentioned in Genesis 48:22 that Jacob bequeathed a piece of ground to Joseph's tribe, which had been purchased by him from the Canaanites. And it was this area here where his well was. So this was Jacob's well, it was called. It is still there. It still produces water. In fact, it's an artesian well. It's not just a hole that has water seeping out of the ground
into it and collecting. It has a spring underneath. It's fed by a deep spring underneath it, so it's got very fresh water. Still to this day, it's a good well. It's about 300 yards removed from Joseph's tomb, where Joshua and the others who brought Joseph's bones into the Promised Land, they buried Joseph. It's quite close to this well. Anyway, this was a well that was meaningful to the Samaritans because they were descended somewhat from Joseph, from Ephraim and Manasseh. But they had intermarried a long time ago, but insofar as Samaritans were aware of any Jewish heritage they had, it was from the 10 tribes in the north, and this particular region belonged to Joseph's descendants at one time. And so that's the well we're talking about here. Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied from his journey, sat thus by the well. It was about the sixth hour. Now, Jesus was wearied from his journey, but God doesn't get weary. It says that in a number of places in the Old Testament. Isaiah says he doesn't slumber, he doesn't grow weary, but Jesus grew weary. And this underscores, of course, the fact that when Jesus was incarnate, when he took on human nature, he didn't just take on a shell that looked human, he became a real human. He took on real human weakness. That's why he didn't know everything when he was on the earth, and he said so. That's why he couldn't be everywhere at once. That's why he couldn't do everything he wanted to. He could only do what the Father gave him to do. The works he did were the Father working through him. And likewise, he didn't have omnipotence. He could run out of energy. He could get exhausted, and he did on occasion. And it says he was exhausted because it was about the sixth hour. Now, the sixth hour by Jewish reckoning would be noon. And so many believe that he arrived at the well about noon. That would be in the Middle East, as in many places in the world, the time for siesta. You know, that's the place where the sun is at its full height. It's a very hot area, very hot climate. And most people would sit in the shade in the midday. Jesus, if this was noon, had been traveling and reached a place where he could rest about in the hottest part of the day. Now, if it was noon, it's unusual that this woman would meet him who met him there because it'd be the most inconvenient time to go out and gather water or do any kind of labor. It would be a time when most people would be in the shade waiting for a better time of the day to gather their water. But it is open to question whether John is using Jewish reckoning of the days of the hours of the day, because he was writing in Ephesus, which was a Roman colony, and many believe, and I incline to this myself, that he was using Roman reckoning, not Jewish reckoning. To the Romans, the day began at midnight, and the hours ticked up 12 until noon, and then started again, just like in our clock. You know, an hour after midnight is 1 o'clock, the first hour. Likewise, an hour after noon is 1 o'clock. And if it's Roman time, then he was either arriving there at 6 in the morning or 6 at night, in other words. Now, if 6 at night, then he'd been traveling, of course, during the day, as anyone might be expected to do. If it was 6 in the morning, then he'd been traveling apparently all night in the dark, a very uncommon thing to do, a very unusual thing to do, and without flashlights and such to light their way, a rather risky thing to do, a hazardous thing to travel over rough terrain in the dark. And so one might think it wasn't 6 in the morning, it was probably 6 in the evening. If it was 6 in the morning and he did travel all night, then it would suggest that he felt it important to escape from Judea under cover of darkness and to do something that would be highly unlikely in most circumstances, that's to travel in the dark. If he did that, then he must have been in a great hurry. When he heard that the Pharisees knew that he was baptizing more than John was, he may have felt there was a pressing danger and that it would be good for him to slip out of the area under cover of darkness, notwithstanding the treacherous conditions that he'd have to travel through without light. Maybe that doesn't seem very likely. However, that would be a rather normal time, 6 in the morning, to gather water. And it's the beginning of the day for most people in that area, 6 in the morning. And so the woman might well come out to gather her water at that particular time. On the other hand, it could be 6 in the evening. If so, it would be unusual to gather water at that time.
because most people started going to bed around 6 when the sun was going down, and she would have probably already eaten, unless she was gathering water for the next morning, hard to say. It seems like the day was ahead of them when this happened, because he had this conversation with her at the well, then she ran and got people who were apparently out in the streets and so forth, as they would not be at bedtime. And then they came, and Jesus spent some time preaching to them and so forth. It sounds like there was some hours of daylight left. So it was either noon or possibly 6 in the morning. As I said, notwithstanding the difficulties that would incur traveling at night and arriving there at 6 in the morning. But again, it seems to me that 6 in the morning would also be the most likely time to find a woman coming to gather water for the day's uses, for cooking and washing and so forth. Of course, the fact that that was the most common time to gather water might be an argument against it, because many people argue that the woman was deliberately getting her water at a time that other people would not, and that if that was the time most people would, then that's the time she would not. That she would in fact come out when she was pretty sure she would run into nobody there, and that could be noon or at night. So, you know, these are the issues to try to decide whether it was morning, noon, or night. On balance, though, I don't think the Bible gives any evidence that the woman was avoiding society, notwithstanding preachers who say it all the time. Preachers continually say this woman had a bad reputation because of her sexual past and that people avoided her and so forth. That's not what I find to be so in the story. People didn't seem to avoid her. When she went and gathered them, they took her seriously. They came out to hear her. They talked to her like any other person. There's no evidence in the whole story that she was an outcast of any kind. As far as we can tell, she was in normal society in Samaria. And that probably seems strange, because preachers always emphasize how much it was so that she was a scandalized woman. But they say that because of her marital history. We know she had had 5 husbands and was now living with another man. Well, the living with another man is not very good, though that might not have been as uncommon in those days as it would be in a Christian society. And 5 husbands might not have been her fault. It depends on the circumstances. Did they divorce her because she was a bad woman? Then that's bad. Did they divorce her because they were bad men? Well, then she might be innocent. She might not be, marred by the fact that she made some bad decisions and married 5 men who ended up being jerks. So there's nothing in this story that kind of seals her reputation in our eyes as a woman of ill repute. Sure, she wasn't living a morally perfect life, but it's not so clear that the other people in town were all that prudish about such things themselves. That might not have been uncommon among them. We just don't know. There's a lot of compromise in Samaria. So, since we have no evidence that she was avoiding society or that she would have any reason to avoid society, there's no reason to believe she would be gathering water when no one else would. And therefore, all other things being equal, it seems that 6 in the morning would be the reasonable time for it to be. But we can leave that undecided. I'm just giving you the options. But it does not seem to be 6 at night, because that's when the sun would go down, and there's a lot of activity that takes place in this story after this point. In fact, the disciples had gone into town to buy food, more likely to be done in the morning than at the heat of the day when the shops would be shut. Or at the end of the day when they're shutting too. You know, it seems much more likely they'd be buying food in the morning as that would be when the shops are open, rather than at high noon or sundown. So those are my thoughts on that. Obviously, you're entitled to take a different conclusion. Now, a woman of Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. Then the woman of Samaria said to him, "How is it that you, being a Jew, ask a drink from me, a Samaritan woman? For the Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Now, she knew he was a Jew immediately. He may have looked very kosher, you know, not like the actors who play him in movies, but he might have actually looked Jewish. If there was, in fact, a look that could be called Jewish back then, when we think of a Jewish stereotype, we're thinking of certain features, obviously, that we might think of a Barbra Streisand or a Woody Allen or Henry Kissinger or someone like that, have very striking features that we are stereotypically, we think of as Jewish. But those features might not be Jewish features. It's possible that those are actually Khazar features, because most of the Jews have those looks have come from Eastern Europe. They're Ashkenazi Jews, and the Ashkenazi Jews centuries ago intermarried a great deal with a Gentile race up there called Khazars. This is just part of Jewish history. And it's hard to know whether those features that we think of as typical Jewish features are really typical Khazar features, and Jews didn't always have them. After all, you'll find Jews in North Africa who are black, and you'll find Jews in Asia that actually have almond-shaped eyes and other Asian features. The Jews intermarried wherever they go, and the European Jews, to a very large extent, intermarried with the Khazars, and that's where those features that we're talking about sometimes are found. To say Jesus looked Jewish, you know, we might immediately think of a Jewish stereotype by our today's reckoning of what a Jew looks like. The Jews might look very different back then. Might not have been that distinctive by looks, but they did have one thing distinctive. According to the law, the Jew had to have a blue boundary on his cloak, or he'd have sort of a shawl that he'd wear, and it had a blue border on it. The law actually required that. It was to remind them of their, you know, heavenly connection with God. And Jesus was Jewish, and he probably had that blue border on his garment, and therefore she would instantly, by looking, know he was Jewish. He might also have had an accent, but it would be Galilean, not Judean. So it's probably by the way he was dressed in a Jewish way that she didn't have to ask where he was from. She said, "You're a Jew, why are you talking to me? Why are you asking me for water?" Jews would never drink from the same vessel with the Samaritans. They have no dealings with Samaritans, typically. Jesus was not typical, obviously. But she didn't know that yet, but she was finding out. I guess in a way she did recognize immediately he was not typical, because he asked her to give him a drink, and he knew she was a Samaritan. So he was not, like most Jews, prejudiced against her race to the point of not being willing to have any contact. By the way, another thing that was a bit of a surprise to her, though it doesn't mention it, is that he spoke to her as a woman. She was perhaps more mindful of this, of the strangeness of a Jew speaking to a Samaritan than of the other strange thing is of a man speaking to a woman in public. In the Middle East, they don't do that. And you'll find that when the disciples come back with the food, it actually says the disciples were surprised to find that he was speaking to a woman, because that too was a breach of social custom. Jesus was neither a racist or a sexist. He did not share in the prejudices of the Jews, though he was a Jew. He would talk to a woman as freely as to a man. Other Jews wouldn't. He would talk to a Samaritan as freely as to a Jew. Other Jews wouldn't. He was not a typical Jew, and she was both Samaritan and woman, and here he is striking up a conversation with her and asking her to share her water. And she said, "Why are you asking me, a Samaritan woman, when you're a Jew?" And he answered and said to her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." Now, if you knew the gift of God, what is the gift of God? He could be referring to himself, because God so loved the world that he gave his only son. Jesus is himself a gift of God, but I'm not sure if he's thinking that way. In the sake, he might be thinking of salvation as the gift of God, because Paul says that it is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. Salvation is the gift of God. Or for that matter, the living water he's offering may be seen as the gift of God. The living water he offers is in fact the Holy Spirit, though that is not clear to her initially. She misunderstands him at first, but the living water is the Holy Spirit. John doesn't tell us so here, but he does tell us a few chapters hence in chapter 7, because Jesus again in chapter 7 of John makes reference to the living water, and there John himself tells us what the living water is. You can look there at John 7, verses 37 through 39. In John 7, 37 and 38 are the words of Jesus, and verse 39 is John's commentary on what Jesus said. But what Jesus said was,
in the middle of verse 37, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink, and he who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. And then the author tells us, but he spoke concerning the Spirit. When he talked about the living water, he's talking about the Holy Spirit, whom those believing in him would receive, for the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. So the time would come when the Holy Spirit would be given. That's the gift of God too, isn't it? So when he says, if you knew the gift of God, in this context, he could have any number of possible meanings. His exact intended meaning is perhaps elusive. Himself, salvation, the Holy Spirit, that is the living water, any of those things could be the gift of God. But he says, if you knew the gift of God, and if you knew who it was, who's asking you for this, instead of being surprised that he asked you, you'd be eagerly asking him to give you water, and he'd give you living water. Now, the term living water is ambiguous in those days, because a well that had an artesian spring at the bottom often was said to have living water, that is, running water, water that's in motion rather than stagnant. Many wells just had water sitting in them. But wells like this one, if you could go deep enough, down to where the springs are, you could get the pure water that's moving, the living water, the running water that was at the deep within the well. And apparently she initially thought that's what he was talking about. Because she said to him, sir, you have nothing to draw, and the well is deep. Where are you going to get that living water? She seems to be saying, you know, yeah, I know there's living water down there if you go deep enough, but you don't even have a bucket and no rope, and this, you know, that's a long way down. How are you going to retrieve that water that you're promising me?